Hello, everyone. Welcome into the Coach Chris Oliver Show. I'm Chris Wells. Coach will join me in just a few moments. This week, we'll take a look back at the Blue Raiders' 44-15 win over Ave Maria at Blue Raider Stadium last Saturday, the 2018 home opener. We'll also preview University of Pikeville, who comes to town this Saturday, September 15th. That kickoff is scheduled for 6:30 p.m. Central Time at Blue Raider Stadium. If you can't be there, you can watch it right here on the Lindsey Wilson Sports Network beginning at 5:45 with Bob Boone and myself. That's our countdown to kickoff. Once again, at 5:45 p.m. Central Time, kickoff at 6:30 at Blue Raider Stadium. Also this week, we'll have our student athlete spotlight. Julian Johns joins me, senior from New Albany, Indiana. We're going to step away for 1 minute. When we come back, Coach Oliver will join me. This is the Coach Chris Oliver Show on the Lindsey Wilson Sports Network. Back to the Coach Chris Oliver Show. Coach joins me now, and Coach, a successful day on Saturday with the win over Ave, and first home game, great crowd,
yeah,
great start. So all in all, a very good day.
Yeah, and the weather cooperated with us. Obviously, when we looked at the forecast on Thursday to Friday, you know, it looked like a chance of thunderstorms, lightning all day long, and we ended up getting it in. It was great weather, so we appreciate. You know, Ave Maria working with us on the kickoff time, the officials, all those things that go into it, and then we still had a great crowd. So it was a great day. You know, we got off on a good start here at our home game, and you know, went 1-0, and it was one of those days where I didn't feel bad, you know, leaving the field. We went 1-0, we met our goal. Just wasn't quite sure about how we played overall, especially offensively and special teams. Felt pretty good about how the defense had played. It was one of those, I think, as you watch the video on Sunday, probably were a little bit sharper than I anticipated. And I think Ave Maria is an improved football team. I think they're going to win some games here. And we knew that they were improved, but we only had one game to go on. And you watch the video, you know, they're a solid football team, especially their front seven on defense. You know, they did a great job. So I think that it was a good day for the Blue Raiders.
Is that normal for you and for your coaching staff to walk away from a game, regardless of whether you win or lose, thinking, okay, yeah, we weren't that sharp, or is the film that big of just letting you know how you play?
I think sometimes it's tough to tell in live situations when you are just one, you know, block or one technique error away from big plays, especially offensively, because it's tough to play with 9 and 10 guys on offense and have one or two guys not doing it. It's tough to have a positive play when that happens. Defensively, as long as you're hustling and tackling and you don't blow coverages and fill a wrong gap here and there, you know, you can make up for some things if the ball goes away. And that's not an excuse about defensive football. That's just kind of the nature of how football works. But sometimes it's tough to tell immediately how close you are in attention to detail on game day. And yeah, so the video does certainly help. I think every coach has immediate thoughts after the game about how things went. And sometimes you turn on the video and you find out you're wrong. You know, and sometimes you find out that, you know, you're pretty close. And, you know, this is one of those days that, you know, we were probably a little bit sharper than I realized immediately after the game.
You're now into your preparation for game number 3. Yeah. I'm curious on this particular group as opposed to past groups, and maybe this is a fair question, maybe it isn't, because we're so early in the season, but how does this group take that film and apply it to even practice and especially in the games.
I think that's one of the challenges that we're going through right now. We're still trying to figure that out. We're still trying to figure out how mature we are and can be as a team. You know, you go out and you win by, 37 points week one and whatever, this week was. And can you take that video? Can you learn from it? Can you stay hungry, for lack of a better term, and want to get better and want to be coached and understand that, better opponents are probably going to be coming down the pipe and we're going to have some tougher games that, we're going to be really tested. And if you just sit back and rest on, we won by 30, everything is good, then, you can't improve it the way that you need. And, we're still figuring out how this team is going to do that. I think I like the mindset of our team meeting on Sunday. We really challenged them up in that regard. And, we said, listen, we can't control anything that Ave Maria does, that Pikeville does, that anybody we play. We have no control over anything that they do with how they prepare. But we have complete control over all of our preparation, whether it's on and off the field and how we sleep, how we hydrate, how we go to class, all those little details that go into that. That's what we have control over. And right now we're probably a little bit inconsistent, maybe a little immature on, being consistent with all those little details that go into giving us the best opportunity to play our best game on Saturday. So, the sky isn't falling. I like our team. I like our squad. But we're still growing up. We're still maturing, and we're still proving it.
And that's not uncommon for any season for them. Yeah. Even if you do have veterans coming back.
Absolutely.
When you have so many moving parts as a football team does, it's not uncommon to be in week three and still trying to grow. You don't want to be the best of the best at this point in time in the season.
Yeah, you want to play your best football in November. And, when I used to have an opportunity to be around Coach Tressel at Ohio State, and, that was one of the things he talked about all the time, is we want to play our best football in November. If we as a team are playing our best football in September, then, we aren't on the right track. We aren't on the right path, so we better be playing our best football in November. Now, that's not going to excuse you for not playing the way you want to early in the season, but it's a progress, and, it's a long-term track, but you only get those 10 or 11 guaranteed opportunities, so you have to make the most of it. But, we talked about all the time, the preseason ranking and all those things, that's because of what the teams in the past have done. The 2018 team, all we've done is gone 1-0 twice. We're ranked number four this week, and we talked about that Sunday. Hey, we'll probably move up from 5-4 in the poll. But, again, that's because of what the 2017 team did. Right. That has nothing to do with what the 2018 team has done. And we got to, continue to understand that, and we got to continue to go out and prove it and earn it.
Lindsey Wilson defeats Ave Maria 44-15 on Saturday to move to 2-0 on the season. Up next is University of Pikeville. They come to town next Saturday, or this coming Saturday, the 15th, 6:30 p.m. Central Time kickoff. It's our one and only scheduled night game during the regular season. We're going to step away for a moment. When we come back, we'll break down our offense, defense, and special teams with Coach. This is the Coach Chris Oliver Show on the Lindsey Wilson Sports Network. Chris Oliver Show. I'm Chris Wells alongside LWC head football coach Chris Oliver. Coach, let's talk about your defense, because you said coming off the field you thought that they played a terrific football game, and they did. They kept the opponent, who had a good running attack against Point the first go around, under 100 yards, limited them. Did 15 points during the game, really 13 points, because the 2 points came off the blocked extra point. For the most part, though, a terrific afternoon.
Yeah, I thought our defense took a big step forward. We were really pleased with how those guys moved from game one to game two, and made a lot of big plays. Like you said, gave up 13 points, scored seven.
That's right.
You know, the defensive touchdown. So, I mean, we almost got it done defense alone. Really limited the big play, had just a couple big plays, but for the most part limited the big play. Big thing is we tackled a lot better than game one. You know, we had way too many missed tackles down in Jacksonville, and, you know, I thought we firmed that up. So I thought it was a big step forward for our defense. We were pleased with how they played.
One of the things that you guys really look at is getting off the field, and this defensive unit really did that, did a great job on third and fourth down.
Yeah, I mean, it was, you know, we were forcing punts and forcing them into situations where they had to give us the ball back, and, you know, felt like every other time we were going out on a series, you know, we were getting that opportunity to call our punt return unit or punt safe unit a few times and getting that defense off the field. It's just a great feeling. Sure. You can send your offense back out, and those defensive guys are coming off the field, and you're high-fiving them and telling them great job. And yeah, we did a great job on third down the other day.
And you mentioned the defensive score. Something about that just kind of lifts the entire team. The scoop and score by Joe Lewis, his third career touchdown. You don't see that too often on a defensive guy have that many touchdowns over his career, but there's just something about that just kind of energizes not only the sideline but also the crowd.
Yeah, it's just a momentum play. I mean, just, you know, take the wind out of the sails of your opponent, and you just add those points on the board, and, you know, it's in an unexpected way. You know, you're not expecting to score on defense on any given play. I mean, you want to say that, but, you know, anytime that happens, it's sort of out of the blue, and that's great for us. Big momentum play. We got to do a better job on our sideline of staying back. You know, we brought the group together. You know, I was a little frustrated in that moment, and, you know, we had a couple sideline penalties in Jacksonville. In week one. One of them was on me. You know, I stepped right in front of the official on a 70-yard touchdown pass, and that was due to that sideline being really small.
Yes.
There was not a lot of room to operate, and, you know, we had a tough time getting back off the field. At our stadium, we're fortunate. We got a lot of room, but that's when you get the sideline penalties is, you know, change of possession. All of a sudden, the officials are going one way and the ball's on the ground and the play's going back the other way. And those officials need room to work, and they're running down the white, and all of a sudden they're putting their foot in the ground and they're sprinting back the other way. And we got players excited and, you know, jumping up towards the field there because they see Joe going the other way, and all of a sudden you get a 15-yard penalty. Those things happen. That's coaching. That's, you know, us preparing them as coaches. So we had a long talk on Sunday about, hey, you know, there's a blocked extra point. There's a fumble, there's a turnover. Those are the times we all need to be looking around, backing each other up, you know, getting away from the sideline. So we had a little powwow on the sideline on Saturday. We'll get it fixed. But it's good that our guys are excited and into the game. We can handle that.
That's kind of been a point of emphasis, though, with officials over the last couple of years.
Yeah.
Is that. But I got to think, I know it was irritating at the time, but if you're going to be assessed a penalty, I guess – that one's not as bad as some of the other ones that happen on the field. Again, I'm not trying to condone it, but you know, your guys are excited, and it's just something that you got to learn from.
Yeah, exactly right. You know, you want guys to be into the game. If you watch that video and you see Joe going back the other way, and our sideline wasn't into it, wasn't jumping around and excited, you'd be more worried about that. So the fact that, you know, all of our guys were into the game and excited and fired up in that moment, you know, I don't blame them. That's what we want to be. You know, we as coaches get excited too. So we'll learn from it and move on. And you know, it's one of those attention to detail moments that we got to do a better job of as coaches.
Special teams, I think they're starting yardage or start where they started on average was like the 21-yard line.
Kick
coverage team was terrific again on Saturday. Thought your punt coverage team when you had to punt was pretty good as well. All in all, I think it was outside of the blocked extra point.
Yeah.
Or not the mishandle of the extra
snap,
point. Yeah. I think it was a good day.
Yeah, I thought it was a solid day. You know, we did have a couple kickoffs go out of bounds. Outside of that, I thought I thought Jared played really well and had a lot of positives. Kickoff coverage was solid.
You're so hard on this guy.
I tell you what, when we get the game where we kick off five times and they're all inside the 25, then we'll sing their praises a little bit more. Listen, we take pride in what we do, and our guys work hard at it, and they know we can continue to get better at it. I'll give credit to Ave Marie. They gave us a look when we punted. They gave us a look that was extremely unusual with where they positioned some of their players. Kind of broke some of our punt block rules, our blocking rules for our punt team, and really challenged us. So we got away with one. They probably should have blocked the punt at one point. The guy just missed it, taking it off the foot, and we got away with one. So, we learned from that as coaches. We got it corrected. And, it was one of those looks that, we've never given our punt team. And they had a nice little scheme drawn up. So they're going to see it now. We'll learn from it and get better. So just some things there that go out on special teams. It's so tough to simulate the speed of special teams, some of the looks that you get, and you just have to continue to be detail-oriented with your technique and your assignments, and, we still have a ways to go on that.
Offensively, you rush for 261 yards, and this is supposed to be a passing program. I don't understand. But again, you sang the praises of your running backs last week, and they continue to produce. Blake Eagleton becomes the all-time leader in the program history in career rushing yards. So, and he wasn't even the team's leading rusher. Yeah. So we were so happy to see Jalen Boyd get some carries after not getting a few carries because of a ding down in Jacksonville. Good to see him back. So all in all, I got to think that you're real proud of the running attack.
Yeah, we're excited about our running backs. Excited about how we finished running the ball in the fourth quarter. And you score a touchdown late, and you could say, well, should we be running the ball? Or we're not throwing the ball. And we really challenged our offensive line because we didn't finish very well in Edward Waters. And we made some substitutions, and we just didn't finish very well down there. So we were challenging our guys all week to finish. Let's play 60 minutes. So for us to run the ball at the end of the game, get some positive yards, that's less about the game situation and more about us growing as a team and growing as an offense. So we were excited to see that. It was one of those games Blake didn't have huge numbers, but really watching the film, thought he played pretty well. They were committed to stopping the run. Yeah. They were going to have their safeties down in the box almost all day. For us to still run for 240 yards or whatever that was, I think that's a really good day for all us offensively with what we're doing. But, we want to take what the defense is going to give us. We want to be balanced. We want to put them in tough situations formationally and motion-wise. And, we were very balanced on Saturday and felt good about a lot of the aspects of the things that we did on offense.
Yeah, and Cameron had another solid afternoon at the quarterback position.
Yeah, he did. We had the one interception. And that was right when it was raining a little bit. He kind of read it wrong, and then he was trying to pull the ball down on the throw, and it slipped out of his hand. You can see it on the video. He recognized it right as he was getting ready to throw that this is a bad decision. And outside of that, I thought he played a really solid game. I thought we were more accurate than game one, settled in on our footwork. We were cleaner there on game one. I thought, for the most part, our protection was a little bit better. We had a few protection issues, but it was a little bit better. We got to keep coming forward on that. But, solid day on offense. We can be better.
44-15, Lindsey Wilson defeats Ave Maria on Saturday to move to 2-0 on the season. We're going to step away for a moment. When we come back, we're going to have our first student-athlete spotlight of the season. It's going to be Julian Johns. He'll join us when we come back. This is the Coach Chris Oliver Show on the Lindsey Wilson Sports Network. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Coach Chris Oliver Show. I'm Chris Wells. In our student athlete spotlight this week, we have Julian Gines. He's a senior running back from New Albany, Indiana. But Julian, one of the things that someone told me a couple of days ago after the Saturday's win over Ave, that they enjoy watching you play on special teams more than anything else that they watch through in the entire day. That's got to make you feel pretty good.
Absolutely. Yes, sir, it does. I try to take pride in everything I do. I try to do everything I do to the fullest, and anything I can do to make the team excited, pump some guys up, make somebody else want to go out there and make a play. That's what I want to do. That's what I want my role to be. So
you're an energy guy. It looks like you absolutely love to play the game of football.
I do. It's the game of football has done so much for me. It's unbelievable. So I try to give it back as much as I can while I still have the time to do that.
Okay, so you know that. You know, the coin toss, whatever, you know you're going to get your first opportunity on the kickoff. What's going through your mind? What's the plan as Jared Doherty is approaching the football to kick off the game?
You know, I try to go out there with really no regard. I just try to go out there and make a play. I know that when the guys next to me, they're gonna do their job. So I know that if I do mine, I have a great chance to make a play. And if I don't, if that's not my opportunity, it's going to be theirs, and I know they're going to do their job. And it's comforting to go out there with a bunch of guys that know exactly what they need to do, and that are going to get the job done, and it makes it easier for me to have the opportunities that I do. So
you bring up an interesting point. Special teams football in a whole, and we've talked about this with Coach Oliver, but football in a whole is maybe the ultimate team sport. Special teams is right there with it. You guys really rely on one another because you have been so good, really, ever since you've been here on special teams, especially on your kick coverage. And you guys really do rely on one another.
Yes, sir. I mean, special teams is an X factor. In high school, I started my career out by special teams. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you get in the newspaper and they're talking about special teams, and that's different. And so I've always taken pride in special teams. It's definitely something, I mean, if you make a turnover on special teams, it's something that's unexpected. And it's something that can really give the team a boost. And I take a lot of pride in it because that's my role. That's the majority of my role on the team is special teams. So I take a lot of pride in it, and I love it. And I just always go out there and try to jumpstart it. And it's definitely an awesome thing. I'm on kickoff return and kickoff.
Right.
So I know I'm always going to be on the field on the first play of the game. And that's always exciting because you're out there, you know, so. It's fun, and it's definitely an X factor, and it's very important. So I take pride in it, and I love playing alongside the guys that take pride in it with me.
Julian's a criminal justice major here at Lindsey Wilson. You're in your final year of eligibility on the football team, a terrific student athlete, by the way. Tell us what you hope to do with your criminal justice major, or are you going down a different path? What do you want to do when you grow up?
I don't ever want to work. I want to love what I do.
Okay.
And I think that's the field. You know, my family supports me in everything I do, but they definitely wanted to see me do maybe something different. They know it's dangerous and stuff, but it's something that I feel like I can excel in. Mm-hmm. It's something that I feel like I can wake up and enjoy and be happy with every day. And, you know, I'm going to have to be a cop for a while. It's not something I necessarily am super excited about. I want to go federal. I want to be DEA, FBI. I think ideally I'd love to be on the SWAT team. And that's my dreams, you know. And I don't know. Different doors open every day. Ever since I've came here, different doors, different avenues have came. And so really, I'm just going to feel it out. I'm going to go where, you know, salaries and stuff takes me. And really just whatever makes me happy. I don't want to wake up and be disappointed in what I'm doing in my life. I want to be happy. I want to try to make a difference. And that's just something that I'm hoping for.
Julian, how much have you grown since you stepped foot on this campus the first day when you moved in, not knowing what to expect? How much have you grown from that day, if you can recall, to right now?
I can. Coming out of high school, I was wild. I was rambunctious. I back home, I'm known as being wild and crazy, but Coach Oliver has been like a father figure. I mean, seeing him and his family, you know, I was invited to his house for senior dinner and stuff like that. It's just, he's made me want to make him proud. The things that he's instilled in me will last forever. You know, as a freshman, you come in and you're coming from different backgrounds. I come from a big city, and it's different. And coming here, it makes you appreciate the outdoors. It makes you appreciate other things than just, you know, being able to go 5 minutes down the road and have anything you desire. Mm-hmm. You know, here you got to make fun. You got to figure things out. You have to manage your time. And it's just made me grow as a man because of all the amazing things that Coach has instilled in us, the college, you know, everything's a family. Everyone cares about each other. And, you know, it's crazy, but I tell my family, my people I love all the time, you know, I can see myself living in a place like this. I can see myself doing some of the things that the people at this college are doing. And it definitely makes you want to make a difference. It makes you grow every day. And, you know, I always say that Liz Wilson was the best decision I've ever made. I've never looked back, and I'm very thankful because I'm still growing every single day. And I think that this school is definitely molded me into the person that I want to be and the person I want to be at this point and continue to grow from here.
You can see why he's so passionate on the football field. He brings that passion with him everywhere he goes. Julian, thanks so much for joining us.
Absolutely. Thank you.
All right. Be back in 1 minute with Coach Oliver. This is the Coach Chris Oliver Show on the Lindsey Wilson Sports Network. Joins me now, Julian Johns, has really grown into just a very likable, not that he wasn't likable early, you just didn't know his energy and everything, but boy, he's such a likable guy, and is such a key cog on that special teams unit.
Yeah, he is. You know, he's earned his way onto the field mainly through special teams, and he does. He just has great energy about him. He's detail-oriented. He wants to be coached. He asks great questions about some of the finer details that, you know, sometimes other guys don't even see. And that's just a maturity and a focus, you know, and he's a guy that, you know, he's a great young man, get it done off the field, in the classroom, he's crushing it, and, you know, he's going to be a huge success in life. And he's, you know, the type of guy you root for. He is a great young man, and you know, he's kind of heart and soul, one of those guys in this senior class that really makes us go.
Lindsey Wilson wins 44-15 on Saturday over Ave Maria. A lot of accolades handed out by the Mid-South Conference to the Lindsey Wilson side. Blue Raiders got three players of the week this past week. Cam Weish on the offensive side. On the defensive side, Mark Pruitt and Jared Doherty on the special team side, all players of the week in the Mid-South Conference. Coach, each week we go through players of the week that the coaches hand out on our team. Let's go through those.
Yeah, and, you know, for us, you know, Mark Pruitt played a great game, and, you know, it's just one of those, or sometimes the guy who leads you in tackles, you know, may not get the Player of the Week award and all those things. We actually gave the Player of the Week award to Michael DeLeon.
Okay.
We thought he played an outstanding game, and Mark did as well. Cam Weish was our Player of the Week on offense. We didn't have one this week on special teams. I felt like we needed to be a little more consistent, but we're happy that Jared got the Conference Player of the Week. Prep offense this week, Robert Cox, Noah Bowman, and Terrell Cole. Terrell Cole, that's 2 weeks in a row. But Robert Cox and Noah Bowman, two guys on the offensive line that are getting it done for us and had a great week. Prep defense, Carlos Falls Wells and Xavier Baugh. Again, big weeks last week for our Prep O and Prep D. We really had a tough time narrowing down the list to a handful of guys. But those are the guys that stuck out. And then Prep special teams, we gave out four this week. Akeel Sledge, Corey Clems, Cage Street, and Cam Stewart. Again, just so tough to simulate special teams at practice, and it takes guys giving great effort. Big hits, Mark Pruitt had one on a tackle in the flat, and Trent Mueller had another. Big plays. Damani Jenkins had a big sack. Joe Lewis, obviously, for the touchdown. C.J. Dickerson for a sack. We gave one to Cameron Thurman for forcing the sack there as well. He also got a missed tackle on that, but he did a great job on the rush and really could have been his sack, but he forced it to C.J., and C.J. cleaned it up. Mark Pruitt had a sack, as everybody, you know, kind of remembers that play. It was just a great pursuit from the backside. You see him running and had his first career sack. It was a great effort in short yardage. Jalen Boyd on a big touchdown, his first one. Cameron Dukes on a touchdown run at the beginning of the game. It was a great effort there and finish. And then Cameron Dukes to Cam Weich on the long touchdown there in the third quarter. The O-line on the last touchdown we referenced earlier, we really challenged those guys up to finish the game better than we did a week ago, and I thought we did that and ended up getting a touchdown run there late and kind of 4-minute drill. And then defense on the block, the extra point, we felt like that was a big play too. So a lot of big plays, and you know, it was a good day for the Blue Raiders.
Lindsey Wilson wins it 44-15 to move to 2-0 on the season. Talked about the special or the players of the week. Lindsey Wilson, first national poll came out earlier this week, and Lindsey Wilson moved up one spot, as Coach alluded to earlier in the show, to number 4 in the country. Up next, University of Pikeville, the lone night game during the regular season scheduled here for Blue Raider Stadium, 6:30 p.m. Central Time. Coach Pikeville comes to town. For the first 5 years, it's a team that we played every year and hasn't played. We haven't played them since 2014, so it's kind of odd since they're so close that that we haven't played them that long. But it's been a good series for Lindsey Wilson. While the Blue Raiders have had great success, there have been a lot of good and close games.
For sure. We've had a number of great contests over the years. Most of them have been extremely close, gone down to late in the fourth quarter. It seems like it's one of those teams that just always very close. And, you know, this is a team that's going to be coming in here that, you know, they're going to be ready to go. It's their first road game of the year. They've got 2 extra days rest because they played on Thursday night. And, you know, this is a team that, you know, this is a big game for them just like it is for us. And, you know, it's going to dictate kind of how they go down the stretch. They're extremely talented at wide receiver. They got 2 quarterbacks. They're rotating in and out, you know, here and there depending on the situation. Both of them are getting it done in a good way. So offensively, you know, this is a team that can score some points. Defensively, they're going to mix up their looks. They're just not going to sit there. They want to mix up their looks, go back and forth between a, you know, a 3-man front and a 4-man front and keep you off balance with that. And, you know, so this is a team that they had a tough draw playing a brand-new program week one.
Right.
A team that you can't scout, can't see on video, and that knows everything about you. That's a tough draw. It's a tough situation, and they had that week one, and then they played great in week two. And you know, so this is a team that, you know, they're going to be ready to go, and we're going to have our hands full on Saturday night. We're excited to get the night game and be back at home, you know, we've got to be ready to go.
Second night game of the season, and I know the first time was in Jacksonville. Team went out to a movie. What do you do at home when you have to wait around all day because you're so used to being on schedule and playing that 1:30 p.m. Central Time kickoff?
Yeah, you know, it's one of those things. You try to occupy time, but you know, you don't want to just sit around either. You know, obviously there's college football on all day. So anytime you're talking to a bunch of football players and you give an opportunity, hey, let's get in for a team meal. Go over some extra meeting time and extra details. But the big thing is just, you know, stay off our feet, stay hydrated, you know, watch some college football, relax, and be ready to go when the time comes when we report to the stadium and go through our normal pregame routine for that, you know, 2.5 or so hours before kickoff. You know, that's when it has to really get locked in and tuned in. And the rest of the day is, you know, off the feet, hydrate, and let's watch some football.
Coach, congratulations on last week's win. Good luck this week.
Thank you.
That's LWC. Head football coach Chris Oliver as the Blue Raiders defeat Ave Maria 44-15 last Saturday. Up next, University of Pikeville again this Saturday, 6:30 p.m. Central Time. If you can't be there, you can join us on the Lindsey Wilson Sports Network. We'll go live with our pregame show at 5:45 p.m. Central Time. You can join Bob Boone and myself for that call. That'll do this week's Coach Oliver Show. For Julian Johns, Coach, I'm Chris Wells. This has been the Coach Chris Oliver Show on the Lindsey Wilson Sports Network.